You can't have a game dev channel without a third-person player controller video, so here's how I implement one in Godot. I start off with a new project and create a new scene called Main, and I go into the project settings and set it as the default scene. I also set the window size to 1366 by 768 pixels because I like that as a base resolution. Finally, I go into the input map section and add WASD keys for the movement actions and space for the jump action. In the main scene, I add a world environment node and a directional light with shadows enabled and begin creating a simple parkour field to test the movement system. To do that, I add the CSG combiner node, enable its use collision flag, and I add in a CSG mesh with a quad mesh to make the ground. I also assign it a spatial material with a dark green albedo color so it looks like a grassy field. For the platforms, I just place some CSG boxes, but since I want to be able to test double jumps, I make sure that some of them are taller. In this example, the standard platforms have a height of 2 units and the taller ones have 4. Finally, I add the CSG polygon node, remove one of its vertices, and reposition another one to match the other platform height to make a slope. To make the player, I've created a folder called player and in it, I create a 3D scene called player. I immediately change its type to kinematic body and assign it to the player group. To make the player model, I add in a spatial node and rename it to skin. For the body, I just use a capsule mesh, but I also like to have a nose so I can tell where my player model is facing, so I add a cylinder mesh and turn that into a cone. Since Godot uses the right-hand coordinate system, the front of our player will be the negative z-axis, so I rotate and reposition the cone to face in that direction. Once I'm done with the model, I add in a collision shape with a capsule shape, and I resize it and rotate it to match the player's body. Finally, I add a camera node, set it's currently enabled, and adjust its angle and position. To preview the camera while repositioning it, you can hit Ctrl+Alt+2 on the keyboard to split screen horizontally, and with the camera selected, enable preview on the second screen. Once you're done, you can hit Ctrl+1 to close the second viewport. I really like having a debugger overlay in my games, and to do that, I create a folder called UI, and in it, I create a new control scene called debugger. In the debugger, I just add a single label, give it a dark background color with an alpha around 160, and also 4 pixels of content margin in all axes. Next, I assign a new script to the debugger, and in it, I get only the references to the label and the player. The player node is already in the player group, so I just call get3.getNodesInGroup method to find its reference. In the process method of the debugger script, I get the player's global position and print it on the label. Once I'm done, I go back to the main scene, add the player, a canvas layer node, and in the canvas layer, I add the debugger scene. Now, when I run the game, I can see the player's position. To implement the player, I go back to the player scene and assign it a new script called player. In it, I define a few export parameters for the movement and give them some default values that work well for this project. Next, I define a vector2 field to hold the current movement direction based on the player's input, and a boolean field to store whether or not the player has pressed jump. In the process method, I use input.getActionStrength to get the strengths of left and right and forward and backwards move actions, and put their differences in the x and y components of the move vector. I also make sure to normalize this vector so the player won't be moving faster when moving diagonally. Next, I check if the player is jumping by calling isActionJustPressed for the jump action and assign the resulting value to the isJumping flag. At this point, I like to check if my controls are working, so I go back into the debugger script and add the values of moveDir and isJumping flag to the debugger text and relaunch the game. Back in the player script, I define a vector3 field to hold the player's current velocity and a float field to hold the vertical velocity separately. In the physics process method, I define a vector3 variable called direction and set its x and z components to the x and y values of the moveDir vector. Next, I linear interpolate the velocity vector from its current value to direction times move speed with a step of acceleration times delta. For grounded movement, I check if the player is on the floor, and if they are, I set the y velocity to -0.01 to snap them to the ground. There are other ways to achieve this snapping behavior, but I won't get into that right now. For the mid-air movement, I go into the as handle of my isOnFloor check, and in it, I decrease the y velocity by gravity. I also clamp the value between negative and positive max terminal velocity. For the jump, I add another if statement and check if the player is on the floor and also if the jump button is pressed. If they are both true, I change the Y velocity to jump force and switch is jumping back to false. Finally, I assign Y velocity to the Y component of velocity vector and I update that with the result of a move and slide call where the up vector is vector 3 up and the max slope angle is the radian version of our max slope angle. I go back to the debugger and add the values of both velocities to the debugger text. Now when I run the game, I can move and jump around, so it's time to do the rotation. For that, I only hold a float value called rotation, and if the player is moving horizontally, I lerp angle it towards the A and 2 of negative move dir dot x and negative move dir dot z with a step of turn speed times delta. Next, I assign the result to the skin's rotation's y component, and that's it. Next, I add the rotation value to the debugger display and relaunch the game. The last thing I need to do is to implement the multiple jump function. For that, I add two more export variables to the player script, one to determine how many times the player can jump, and another for how long they have to wait in between each jump. Next, I derive two more fields from these, one to hold the current number of jumps, and another to count towards the cooldown. In the first isOnFloor check in the physicsProcess function, I set both of these fields to 0, and in the else handle of it, I just decrease the jump cooldown remaining by delta. Then, I remove the isOnFloor check from the second if statement and replace it with two more checks, one for the jump count and another for the jump cooldown. Now the player can jump while in midair. Next, I go inside the if statement and set the jump cooldown remaining to jump cooldown and increase jump count by 1. Let's add these to the debugger text and see if it works. Cool, now I can jump twice and reach on top of the taller platform, and I can even increase max jump count to 3 to jump 3 times. That's it for this video. I know this is pretty basic stuff, but in upcoming videos I'll be adding stuff like collision-aware gimbal camera systems, mobile controls and better slope movement on top of this implementation. As always, you can find links to the example project in the description box below. Thanks for watching.